Good evening and a very warm welcome to our university and skill intelligence productivity webinar series. I'm glad to share with you that today is our 40th webinar in the series. And in this long journey of 39 webinars, we have tried to share some good practices, tools, and techniques that can be implemented at the shop floor for productivity enhancement and the cost optimization and create a culture of continuous improvement. Today's webinar is on the project management. Project management is the process of leading the work of a team to achieve goals and meet success criteria at a specified time. The primary challenge of the project management is to achieve all of the project goals within the given constraints. The webinar will briefly focus on what is a project management, overview of 5 process groups and 10 knowledge areas, risk management, monitoring and controlling project scope, schedule, cost, quality, and risk. Our university has partnered with SkillTelligent to offer technical shop floor training to existing industry workforce. We at our university aim to work closely with industry, bringing them structured and formal education, training and skilling programs on lean methodologies, industrial best practices, technical skills, and operations management. I take this opportunity to introduce you about the Aura University and SkillTelligent. Established in the year 2011, Aura University is the first private university in South Gujarat with UGC recognition located in Surat. It is grounded in value-based education and focuses on integral and transformational learning inspired by the philosophy of Sri Aurobindo's vision of integral education. It offers undergraduate, postgraduate, and PhD degrees under its various schools like School of Business, Information Technology, Law, Hotel Management, Mass Communication and Journalism, Liberal Arts, Design, and School of Science. SkillTelligent. SkillTelligent is engaged in the business of providing quality skilling and reskilling solutions to employed industrial workforce. SkillTelligent has executed many assignments to improve the skills of shop floor workers, their productivity, competency, work-related interpersonal communication skills, as well as for training to establish manufacturing best practices and methods within their employment work environment. SkillTelligent also undertakes productivity improvement and lean practices implementation projects with a focus on training to the workforce for sustenance. I take this opportunity to brief you about today's speaker, Mr. Atul Garg. Mr. Atul runs the SkillTelligent Solutions as director of the company. He is the past chairman of CII Gujarat State Council and has been on the several regional and national committees of CII. He has more than 3 decades of experience in the IT industry and has built several software products in his earlier company. He is also certified Safe Agile Coach. He has extensive experience in manufacturing systems, processes, and building competencies in the shop floor teams. With all this, welcome you, sir. Over to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Kishore. Let me just share the screen. Okay. All right. So, good evening, friends. And as Kishore mentioned, today is our 40th webinar. We never realized that, you know, in the past 45, 46 weeks, we have actually done, you know, almost 40 webinars. And today we have taken a slightly different topic. We have not gone into the lean topic, but we have taken a generic topic called project management. Okay, project management is always at the core of nearly every business initiative, and it is a means of achieving a strategic objective. It is the key to the organizational success. As the economy and the enterprise landscape become more competitive and chaotic than ever, effective project management is necessary for businesses to perform better, faster, and more efficiently. In the world of disruptive technology, the payoffs from investing time, money, and resources into effective project management can be tremendous. And actually, there is opposite is also true as well. So if we look back at the Project Management Institute, they say that for every $1 billion that companies in the US spend on projects, they actually see an estimated loss of $122 million, which means that 12% of the budget for projects on average goes down the drain. And one of the key reasons behind this staggering loss is the poor management. So not surprisingly, leading companies worldwide are embracing the project management as a way to cut cost, improve efficiencies, boost customer and stakeholder satisfaction, and even gain the competitive advantage. So for many such companies, project management has become a very dedicated function. And even if you look at the close home also, large companies like even L&T or Reliance or Builder Groups, they always would have a project management office, which would be looking into their own projects to be implemented within the organizations. Okay. So today we will discuss what is project management, have an overview of 5 process groups and the 10 knowledge areas, look slightly in detail on the project schedules, development, risk management, and monitoring and controlling the projects. Okay. Initially, I thought that we would also talk about the lean and agile project management, but then realized that, you know, even the core project management itself is a vast subject and we will not be able to do the justice to both together. So maybe lean and agile project management, we'll take it up into some other webinar exclusively, and also look up at how do the PDCAs and other things also collaborate into it, and how do you take it into lean side of it. Okay. So according to the PMBOK, which is the project management body of knowledge, a project is defined as a temporary endeavor with a beginning and an end, and it must be used to create a unique product, service, or result. Okay. What this definition of a project means is that projects are those activities that cannot go on indefinitely and must have a defined purpose. Okay. So a project is an activity to meet the creation of a unique product or service, and thus activities that are undertaken to accomplish routine activities cannot be considered projects. So here the word or the term temporary does not apply to the result or services that is generated by the project. The project may be finite, but not the results. Results can continue to be, you know, infinite over there. So also a project must be progressively elaborated. This means that the project progresses in steps and continues by increments. This also means that the definition of the project is refined at each step, and ultimately the purpose of the progress is enunciated. This means that a project is first defined initially, and then as the project progresses, the definition is revisited and more clarity is added to the scope of the project as well as the underlying assumptions about the project. Okay. A project usually is constrained by 3 elements, and which may be expressed in different ways. The triple constraint theory, and sometimes certain people also call it as an iron triangle in project management, it defines the 3 elements, which are scope, time, and budget. Or it could be even, you know, their variation like a scope, schedule, and cost, or good, fast, cheap, whatever way you want to define it. But this is a triangle under which, you know, the projects work. While the names of these 3 elements of the triangle, they can keep on changing, they all measure essentially the same thing: a fixed budget, a fixed schedule or timeline, and a fixed set of expectations or deliverables. That's what the project is all about: delivering certain deliverables as expected on a particular timeline in a fixed cost. So that is what this is. And this is where, you know, this triangle also comes into play when something affects one of its legs. If that happens, you may need to adjust one or both of the other elements to accommodate the change. For an example, if a client suddenly shortens a time frame, then obviously you would require more resources, or maybe you will have to reduce the scope. Either of the thing or both of the things may have to be done if one factor is changing over here. So that's why we call it the iron triangle. It's ironclad. All the 3 are, you know, interlocked. Okay. So what is project management? So project management is the application of processes, methods, skills, knowledge, experience, whatever you call, to be able to achieve the specific project objectives according to the project acceptance criteria within the agreed parameters. And project management has always final deliverables that are always constrained to a finite time scale and budget. We are going back to the iron triangle: time scale, budget, and the cost or deliverables. Okay. The primary challenge of a project management is to achieve all of the project goals within the given constraints. And objective of the project management is to produce a complete project which complies with the client's objectives. Okay. So that is what the project management is. I thought we will just take a quick look onto the history of project management. And, you know, we may think that project management is something very new. It may be 30, 40 years old kind of a thing. But no, actually, it has been, you know, around for thousands of years. If I even look back, I'm sure that, you know, even building up the great pyramids or hanging gardens of the Babylon in the mythological way, or multiple, you know, projects which we have seen, or the old structures we see, they all would have required the planning, coordination, and, you know, great skills into constructing them. So I'm sure that there would have been some kind of the project, you know, management skills over that time also. So if we look back as a short walkthrough, even in the ancient times, right from the 18th century onwards, we have the seven wonders. We have the Senchu's art of war, and we have the building of various structures in permanent settlements. And all of them are the complex projects in their own way. In 19th century also, if you look, we have the numerous railways and the manufacturing processes, which have been demanding very high-end, you know, project management skills and tactics. And if you look, the Transcontinental Railroad, that is considered to be the first large-scale project management, you know, experiment. Okay. Then 1900 to 1949, we have the Henry Gantt, who actually, you know, founded the modern project management, and he also created the Gantt chart. Okay. Then 1950 to 1980s, I think the post-World War II, the project management actually started beginning to follow two mathematical processes. And one of them was the PERT, which is Program Evaluation Review Technique. And then second was the critical path method. Okay, so they started coming in. I think 1980s onwards, the computers started coming in. And then when the computers started coming in, the technology, as it started growing, the project management moved onto computers. And then that's where you had, you know, variety of the software tools and other things coming in picture to support the project management. Okay, so if I look back, today's project management actually casts a very wide net, and it is relied upon to actually help increase profits or boost return on investment or have a positive impact on the productivity and mitigate the risk. We also have several tools and techniques developed over a period of time. As I said earlier, we had Henry Gantt, you know, develop the Gantt chart, which is nothing but a visual schedule that helps to plan, manage, and track the specific task in a project. Then DuPont Corporation in 1957 developed the critical path method, which is nothing but an algorithm for scheduling a set of project activities. PMI, Project Management Institute, was launched way back in 1969 to promote the project management profession. Then Scrum, this was named as a project management style again in 1986. This is where, you know, a lot of agile software models have been developed, and this is primarily used into the IT industry to, you know, develop or to do the project management over there. PRINCE, that is another, you know, method which was derived from a department called PROMPT in the UK government agencies, and this became the UK standard for all kind of the government information projects. Then we had the total cost management framework, which was released by AACE in 2006. It actually is the first integrated process or methodology for portfolio, program, and project management. These are the three hierarchies actually we have. I'm sorry, I forgot to, you know, add up something more about it, but portfolio is the largest level where you actually have got, you know, all kind of the major projects, major programs housed under the umbrella called portfolio. And under the portfolio, then you have the major programs happening, major initiatives happening, and then you have the grounds level activities happening as the projects under the program. So that's a hierarchy which is being maintained into this. Okay. So let's take a quick look in terms of the project manager also, because essentially at the end of the day, you also have to have a project manager who would be, you know, managing the projects. So project manager has the responsibility of the planning, procurement, and execution of a project in any undertaking that has a defined scope or a defined standard and a defined finish, regardless of any industry or a function. Okay. These guys are the first point of contact for any issue or discrepancies which could be arising from or within, you know, the various departments in an organization, before, you know, the problem starts escalating to the higher authorities or the, you know, bigger stakeholders into it. Okay. A project manager must possess a diverse skill set that includes the leadership capabilities and the strategic management skills. And he should be proficient with technical aspects of the project, including the scope, risk and schedule management, data gathering and lifecycle management. He should be a strong leader because that is where it allows him to, you know, manage the teams, maybe even across the globe, and then do the conflict management, problem solving, team building, and innovative ideas, which can, you know, save the time and resources. Okay. And he has to be adept in managing several projects at once and ability to quickly react to the ever-changing need within that project requirement or within the industry at large as well. Okay. So that is what the role of a project manager is into. What we are going to talk about as a center theme of this webinar is the 5 process groups and the 10 knowledge areas which have been defined by the, you know, Project Management Institute. And that is what we are going to touch upon briefly to give you an idea about what exactly happens. And then we'll pick up 3 very specific areas to talk a little bit more about it. So 5 process groups. These are the 5 process groups which have been identified by the, as I said, PMI, Project Management Institute. And again, coming back on this, we know that project management is a complex and interdisciplinary field. So you have to have, you know, all kind of the cross-functional teams and cross-functional areas integrated and brought under the umbrella of the project management. Okay, so PMI has actually identified 49 project development management processes, and they have been grouped under the 5 phases of the project management, which are called as the conceptions and initiation, then planning, then execution, performance and monitoring, and then the project closure. So even project closure is a very important phase, because if you're not closing the project effectively, then project may continue to live and it may not serve its purpose as desired into it. Okay. So a project manager's technical expertise, skills and mastery of this project management basics are very essential in completing the project according to a plan. Okay. And there are, you know, different project management frameworks which have come up now, like the PMP is from the PMI. Then you have the PRINCE, PRINCE 1, PRINCE 2, which we just talked about, the UK model, then IPMA and so on and so forth. But what exactly is the most famous one right now is the project management framework, which is called the PMP, Project Management Professional. And that's exactly what we are going to talk about when we talk about these, you know, 5 types of the project phases. So before we go into that, we know that all the projects will be going through some or the other stages, and there is no one way to accomplish a particular project. So that's why a project typically use one of the project lifecycle approach, which essentially is, you know, the 3 parts. Either it is predictive, or it is iterative and incremental, or it is, you know, adaptive. Okay. So let's just quickly look into all the 3 of them. So predictive type of the project management lifecycle, the project's scope, time, and budget, they're determined early on and plans are made around them. And the projects falling under this category include projects you have already done before, so that you know that what exactly is to be expected during the each phase, and you have a clear picture of what has to be done over here. So that's why they are predictive, because you know about them, you have the prior experience of doing them, and you can, you know, predict about it. For an example, a construction company having built, you know, 10 large buildings can very easily predict that what the 11th building construction project will look like. So that's what is the predictive. Then you have the iterative or the incremental type of the project. And that is the project where iterative starts with a product with basic functionality, and then it is redefined in the subsequent iterations or development cycles until the final product is complete. So you keep on growing over here. You keep on improving the design quality and functionality, and project is incremental. I build something and then I realize something and then improve upon it. If the design is not appropriate, make a change and then go ahead and execute, test it, and then, you know, build upon that one after another. So it is little things are added up every time till all the requirements have been satisfied. So that's why it's iterative or incremental. Then you have the 3rd type, which is the adaptive. And this is used in the projects where rapid and constant changes is the norm. And normally the rapid and constant changes are usually seen into the IT projects. That's where the adaptive lifecycle methodologies require the project managers to constantly adopt the approach based on the customer feedback and change the project management timelines, the scope, and the assumptions. So that's where you have to keep on adapting based upon what the change is there. So it's more of a change-driven kind of the approach over here. Okay. So let's go back and look at the five phases of the projects as defined by the Project Management Institute. So the first is the initiation phase. And this phase establishes whether or not the project has a purpose that is in line with the company's direction and objectives. It is the stage in which you gather information for the initial project budget, the types of the skills which the project requires, and whether or not the company will benefit in terms of the return on investment. The documents you may have to create during this phase may include even, you know, business cases which justify the project's existence and outline such benefits. The feasibility study, which is conducted to understand if the company should even do the project. It also questions back, you know, or provides the answer about funding, resources, timelines, and so on and so forth. So once the project is given the go ahead, the next order of business is to create the project charter, which when approved, actually, you know, authorizes the project manager to continue with project planning. And normally the charter would contain things like name of the project manager, project team and their individual responsibilities, who are the stakeholders in the project, project's objective, what is the scope of it, what are the deliverables, timeline and budget, and so on and so forth. So once you have this initiation phase, you end up coming out along with a project charter with a very clear definition of what needs to be achieved and who will work upon it and how. Okay. Then you have got the second phase, which is the planning phase. This is actually one of the most important stage in a project's life. Okay. Here you create the detailed plans for the next phase of the project while keeping in mind the project's requirements and your organization's limits. I would like to add up something over here from my personal experiences that most of the time, most of the projects I have gone through and I've seen, they are not front loaded. When I say the planning has to be done upfront, that's what we say, the front loading the project. That is, we are trying to identify, we are trying to de-risk the entire project. We are trying to think through all the scenarios which could happen. And then based upon that, you know, work out a mechanism of addressing the project requirements. What happens is that we don't do that and we are constantly in a reactive mode. And only in the end, we realize that we are not on the track. And then we go into the firefighting into that. So if I take the entire time put together, actually our lead time of delivering a project increases dramatically. And some people even have the notion that if I put it so much of the time in planning upfront, when am I going to execute it? But fact remains that if you don't plan, your lead time actually increases. Planning actually shortens the lead time. So if you can put a focus onto the planning phase more aggressively, this will always help. And that is what we do over here. We gather the requirements, we, you know, understand what is needed, what has to be done. We also work out the budgets. We also identify the risk. We also try to, you know, look into how to mitigate those risks. We even create the workflows that how this entire project can be, you know, delivered. We look up at the procurement plans. We look up at the suppliers. We also look up at that what kind of, you know, quality plan we should have, and so on and so forth. So that is what we do it into the planning phase over here. The third phase comes in is the execution stage or the phase where project is generally what people think of when they hear the phrase project management. And this is the point where actual execution starts happening and you start pushing it into, you know, execution mode. Okay. So whatever plans you have created so far in the one and two phase, they are put into the motion to build the tangible deliverables, substantial, accurate deliverables. Okay. So activities which you can carry out into this project management phase can also be, you know, even the meetings which you hold along with everyone to have them on the same page, communicate the relevant updates and discuss bottlenecks. You even assign the task to the team members based upon their competencies and capabilities. You procure the resources based upon whatever the plan has been laid out or as and when they are available. Tasks are performed to, you know, carry out the execution. You test and you validate that whether the deliverables meet the quality requirements or not. You also create, you know, various kind of the project management reports to let the stakeholders, especially the funding agencies, know that where you are the things happening correctly or not? Do we need some kind of, you know, corrective action into this? You manage the risk and problems which are pertaining to the three angles, which are the schedule, the scope, and the budget. And then you update the schedules and the budget trackers, and you continuously modify if the project plan needs modification to remain on track. Okay, so that's what the execution phase is all about. The fourth phase is the monitoring and the control phase. Okay, and this phase usually occurs at the same time along with the execution, and it deals primarily with tracking and measuring the project's progress using certain, you know, key performance indicators over here. Okay, and the goal is over here to make sure that the project is moving along as planned. It is not, you know, skidding off the schedule or skidding off the scope or the cost over here. So activities which we do over here is we continuously verify and control the project's scope. We use the techniques like maybe earned value management to measure the amount of work performed to do it, measuring cost and deviations, calculating the schedule variances and the cost variances, creating the project reports or conducting the review meetings, and so on and so forth. So any mechanism by which you can monitor and control the project so that the project doesn't skid off its objectives. The last phase, which is defined over here, is the closure phase. And though it is final, but it's not, you know, less significant, because this is the phase which decides whether the project is successful or not. Okay, activities in this stage are all, you know, aimed towards wrapping up the project, which is delivering the project's final deliverables to the customer, releasing resources from this project to the other resources, other projects, or maybe even to the bench if required, terminating the contracts if the contract is over, or if you have employed the contractors on the project, or, you know, even finalizing the documentation for the project, or evaluating the team performance, or even doing a postmortem analysis to look back in hindsight that, you know, what went good, what went wrong, and how to improve upon it, and so on and so forth. And finally, even disbanding the team after the project is over. So that's a closer phase of this entire, you know, the five phases of the project management over here. Okay. What we will go into is now the 10 knowledge areas, which also, you know, come into play over here. Okay. So, excuse me. So PMI once again has divided the large number of large areas of project management into 10, you know, easily manageable areas. We call them as the knowledge areas, and they're all identified as part of the project management body of knowledge, PMBOK, which is a very well-known and well-accepted, you know, guidelines or rule book for managing the projects. Okay. So these project management knowledge areas coincide with the process groups. They are not independent of the process group. They all work in, you know, hand in hand with each other. But for the purpose of managing them well, they have been separately bodied up. Okay. So knowledge areas actually take place during any one of those five process groups. So it is not that, you know, scope management will happen only into the initiation. Scope management can also happen even into the monitoring and control, okay? Because that's where I still need to manage my scope over there. So knowledge areas happen as part of any of the process groups at any particular time as it is required, okay? So you can think of the process groups as horizontal, whereas the knowledge areas are vertical. And that's where you have a matrix, and which, you know, is providing us the core technical subject matters and is necessary for effective project management over here. So what are these 10 knowledge areas? They are the integration management, which is the center part over here. We start from there. Scope management, time or schedule management, cost management, resource management, communication management, quality management, procurement management, risk management, and stakeholder management. Okay. So these are the 10 areas where the knowledge has been concentrated, processes have been defined, input, output, and processing has been identified so that you can actually execute these areas effectively. Okay. Okay. So what holds a project together? And what holds the project together is nothing but the project integration management. which includes, you know, the fundamental plans as developing a project charter, which we create during the initiation phase. We also have, you know, project management plan overall, which is developed as a project roadmap for the project to reach a successful end. So charter and project roadmap, two specific documents come in as part of this thing. Once you have these things and you have the plan is approved by various stakeholders or the sponsors of this particular project, then that is what is monitored and tracked through a change log at the project progress. So project integration area, it also includes the directing and managing of the project work, which is the production of its deliverables. And this process is monitored, analyzed, and reported on to identify and control any changes or problems that might occur. Okay. Also, any change control that will be carried out over here, this might require, you know, a lot of documentation and approvals and other things, but this is a critical part. And project integration management continues right up to the project closure phase, because even at the closure also, you may have to integrate certain things and bring it to an end point over here. The major part, the first major management area comes in at the project, the scope management, where the scope obviously relates to the work of the project. And once you have the, you know, detailed requirement of the final product or services collected, we call it as a scope overall, which has to be delivered as part of the project, right? So we start with a scope statement. This could be anything from a sentence to a list of to-dos, which is comprehensive to reduce the major project risk. And it could also have a work breakdown structure, which is a graphic breakdown of project work and is, you know, embedded into the scope management activities. Validation scope, we need to validate the scope during the project, which means that the deliverables are being approved regularly by the sponsors or the necessary stakeholders. And this can happen during the monitoring and control processes, or is also, you know, done at the different other phases of the project management. Okay. Scope statement probably is going to change over the course of the project, and that's bound to happen if we have a change in the technology or if we have a change into the requirement coming in because of the external conditions which are out of our control. Then in that case, you know, the scope management becomes a very important part to ensure that we don't deviate too much, and whatever the new scope is there or variations are there, that scope is still manageable, and somehow or the other we can manage the budget and the timelines. Okay, so that's the scope management overall. Project management obviously, you know, has to focus on the schedules or the time, because any project will require some time to deliver. And if we don't manage our time, then time can slip very badly and we can, you know, end up having a cost overrun into it. So that's why we divide the projects into tasks, and each of the tasks are, you know, scheduled along with the start date and the deadlines, and also even with some kind of a budget for each of the tasks over here. Okay. And this particular activity, schedule management, happens across all the five phases of the project. This involves, you know, creating a schedule for the project, determining who is responsible for doing what. It also means that we define all kind of the activities, whether as a task, subtask, or anything like that. Okay, we may or may not create a work breakdown structure, but we definitely create a task list which captures everything of the project to be done over here. Okay, once we have the task, then normally we define even the dependencies. We say that, you know, the task one to task two, it will finish to start, or have a finish to finish, or a start to start, or a start to finish, so that, you know, activities are sequenced. They could be parallel. They could be starting one after another. They could be starting midway. They could be starting all together. So that sequencing of the activities based upon the resources availability and based upon the priorities and, you know, natural sequencing of the actual progression is what we take in consideration and create the schedules over here. Okay. Once we have the task sequence, then we even assign the resources to them. We also estimate the time for each of the activity. And that's where we, you know, say that we have got a schedule in place. And then we put in the controls around that particular schedule. So earned value management and other things are performed regularly to ensure that, you know, the actual plan, whatever we laid out as a schedule over here, proceeds well and it doesn't, you know, waver off too much. Project cost management is the next one. And this area involves the project budgeting, which means that having good estimates, estimating tools to make sure that the funds cover the extent of the project and are being monitored regularly to keep stakeholders or sponsors informed. Remember that every stage in the project, sponsors and stakeholders must always be informed, because they are the ones who can either take a call saying that I need to, you know, stop the project or cut down on certain things or change the direction, and everything which requires a, you know, costing or time or some other factors will have to be approved by these guys. So that's why a constant communication is a very important part over here. Okay. So cost management will always, you know, this entire part will always determine the method to establish the budget, which includes how and how, if it is, will change, then what procedures will be used to control the change into the budget. As I said earlier in the schedule, each task will have its own estimates for the cost, which means that, you know, all resources like even the labor, material, equipment, even, you know, the licensing, all those things will be calculated out over here and estimated for completing the task over here. Okay. And when you combine all this kind of the cost factors, that's where you end up having a project budget overall. So quality management is another area. Obviously, if I'm delivering a project and it doesn't have a quality, you will have, you know, problems. Maybe your stakeholders, maybe your customers will not accept it, and you may run into the massive losses over there. So it's very important that whatever we do, quality is meeting up the standard set as part of either a charter or as part of the international standards or industry standard, as the case may be, right? So this, again, we have to have a quality plan. And quality plan has to be coexisting into various activities being done into the project management. And those standards have to be also regulated over here. So what it will mean is that every deliverable may have to go through some kind of a testing, some kind of a validation, or, you know, verifications or inspections to ensure that, you know, all kind of the standards which have been outlined in the quality management plans are being met overall. The next one obviously is the resource. And if I don't have the resources in terms of the material, man, machine, and so on and so forth, I will not be able to deliver a particular project. So I have to have a process which, you know, calculates and defines the resource management. It identifies the resources required over here. And if it is humans, then in that case, I should also have the job descriptions. I should also have that how many people I would require, what kind of the competency I will require. If I have got this thing to do along with the machines, then again, I should have, you know, a list of what kind of the machines I require to, you know, execute this particular activity, and so on and so forth, right? So that's where the resource management comes in. Usually into project management, most of the people focus on the human resource management over there, including the new hires to be done, rapidly scaling up the teams to do this particular work, bringing in the right kind of the competencies, bringing in the right kind of the expertise to, you know, handle the certain specific tasks, and so on and so forth. But resource also extends over into the various other areas also, that is the man, material, method, machine, and so on and so forth as well. Okay. We talked about the necessity for communication to the stakeholders and the, you know, the sponsors. So this goes without saying, every time we do something, the communication management is a very important part. We have to have a plan that what gets communicated to whom and when and how. The communication plan is a critical step into any kind of a project over here. And this is the point where we decide that, you know, how the information will be disseminated, how it will be, you know, given to the people, what is the method of giving it, at what frequency we have to say it, who are the target audience to whom we have to give it over. You know, all these things become the part of the communication plan overall. And you have to ensure that the communication is constantly happening and is being, you know, the center part of the project management, so that for any kind of a feedback as required is possibly available and stakeholders and sponsors can jump in as required. Okay. Risk management. This is a crucial one. You know, this risk management knowledge area helps you in identifying that how the risk can be itemized, categorized, and prioritized. Okay. If we don't focus out on identifying the risk, if we don't understand that what kind of the risk are there into our project, and we don't, you know, do the qualitative or quantitative analysis of our risk, and we don't have a risk mitigation or a risk response plan ready, then we will, you know, when a risk happens, we will not have a way to mitigate it. Risk can occur from multiple angles. There's no single way in which the risk will occur. It could be that I may have a shortage of the resources. I may have a natural disaster occurring, like even pandemic in this particular case. Or it could be even, you know, a breakdown into the equipment. I may have a design change. I may have suddenly shortage of the finances. You know, all these are the risks which gets involved into a project. We need to identify, we need to categorize them, and we need to prioritize that how we will handle if any of these risks needs to be mitigated, or what if those scenarios happen, and then what we'll do to manage it out. Okay, so that's about the risk management over here. Procurement management is again important because not everything will be built by us into a project. We may be even hiring the subcontractors. We may even have the suppliers. We may even have the outsiders who would, you know, produce certain things for us on a contract basis, right? There may be certain people who may be even hiring out the equipments on the need basis for the project to us. So how are we going to control these procurement processes? By managing and monitoring, and then by, you know, closing these contracts when the work has been done, is all part of the project management, project procurement management. Okay, so that's the ninth one over here. The 10th knowledge area is actually the project escape stakeholder management. Okay, so needless to say, you know, this stakeholder management is usually ignored. Most of the time, you don't, you know, put a lot of focus into it. But we have to be very clear that we are doing the project for some stakeholder. We are not doing it for ourselves. There are certain stakeholders who are supposed to benefit out of this project. And these stakeholders at the end of the project must become happy. Okay. And if they're not happy, then the project would not have achieved its objective over here. So that's why it becomes very important that we actively manage the stakeholders as well, like we do the other parts of the project, like the communication, procurement, risk, scope, cost, all those kind of the things. Okay, so it becomes very important that we must identify who are the stakeholders for our project and you know, look after them. Usually it is not so difficult to identify stakeholders, but in certain projects, stakeholders can be very difficult to identify as well. Okay, for an example, if I'm doing a large construction project, stakeholders can be multiple. It could be even the guy who is selling the land to you to let a new road be developed. He is also a stakeholder into the entire thing. Okay, and he has to be satisfied. If he is not satisfied, he may not part with that particular land and obstruct the entire road to be built over there. Right. So stakeholders can be multiple. They are not just the financiers. They are not just the sponsors. They are not just the directly you know, visible people associated along with the project, and so on and so forth. They are way beyond that also. So that's why there is a complete stakeholder plan which has to come up, which means that you list all kind of the stakeholders, you prioritize what their concerns are and how they can impact your project. And then that's where, you know, you start mitigating and managing their expectations, and you constantly communicate along with them and help them out into this. Okay. One critical thing which we can talk is, let's say, the bullet train project. If you see in the bullet train project also, the multiple stakeholders, including the governments. So though it could be, you know, assumed that the governments are part of this entire thing and they're initiating it. But if you know that Maharashtra government has canceled their part of the, you know, bullet train project. So as a stakeholder, somebody had to manage them as well. And they have to be brought in into the system and they have to be kept happy. Otherwise, if they walk off, the project also gets into a big, you know, trouble overall. Okay, so that's what the project stakeholders are. So these are the 10, you know, knowledge areas into the project management, which are identified as the 10 knowledge areas, which are, again, to repeat back, integration management, scope management, time or schedule management, cost management, resource management, communication management, quality management, procurement management, risk management, and stakeholder management overall. Okay. So, as I said in the beginning, that you know these phases are also kind of mapped to each other. So we have these knowledge areas which are vertical, and you have you know the process areas which are horizontal, and they all crisscross at some point or the other, and that's where the technical areas come up, and that's how you manage a particular project over here. If you would have noticed over here, the stakeholder is missing because the stakeholder is omnipresent across the board. So that's why it is taken as a granted that the stakeholders will have to be managed at each process area and at each stage constantly. Okay, so this is how we have a, and again, if you would look over here, planning process would span over all kind of the knowledge areas, and same with the monitoring and the controlling process groups. Okay. So let's look into the three specific areas, and we'll talk a little bit about them. Project management from the schedule perspective, that's the first one which I will take up. And as we know that, you know, whatever the size or the scope of the project, the schedule will always be the key part of the project management overall. And this schedule tells us when each activity should be done, what has already been completed, and the sequence in which the things have to be done over here. And we usually call that, you know, the scheduling is not exactly a very absolutely science kind of a project. It's a part estimation, part prediction based upon your previous experience and knowledge area, and also part educated guess, because you don't know that what risk will hit you. So you also take a, you know, educated guess over here. So it's estimation, prediction, and educated guessing. Okay. Because of the uncertainty which are involved into the project, that's why we constantly review the schedule, and we always revise it if, you know, project is in progress and is lagging somewhere or is leading or galloping somewhere. So we also, you know, adjust the schedule constantly over here. Okay. So schedule inputs, you actually require certain inputs to, you know, make a project schedule. One is a personal and project calendars. That's where we need to understand that what are the working days, shifts, resource availability of the different people, their you know, vacations or their non-availability or so on and so forth. So we have to have the personal and project calendars, which tells us the availability of the people and the work timelines. Okay. Second is we need to have a description of the project scope. And that's where we are able to, you know, determine that what are the key start and the end dates, what are the major assumptions behind the plan, what are the key constraints and the restrictions. And we also take the stakeholder expectations, and then all this helps us into determining the project milestones, right? Then the next we have to go is into the project risk. That is where we need to understand that we have enough extra time or enough extra resources to deal with the identified risk. You know, if we already know the risk, then we should have a mitigation plan. And if we don't have the risk, then we definitely have got some kind of, you know, a escape route or some kind of the margin kept to be able to address those kind of the unidentified risk as we go. Okay. And the last is the list of activities and the resource requirements, so that we know that what activities we have to do, what are our to-do list, and what resources we require to deliver those to-do list over here. Okay. Then there are certain tools which we also use in the scheduling. So three major schedule tools come into picture. One is the network analysis. What this is basically is a graphic representation of the project's activities, the time it takes to complete them, and the sequence in which they must be done. The project management softwares are also available, which usually, you know, will help you into plotting the Gantt charts and the PERT charts. And these are the common formats in which, you know, the network analysis is done. Then you also have the critical path analysis, where it is the process of looking at all of the activities that must be completed, and you should be able to calculate the best line or the critical path over here, so that, you know, you can complete the project in the minimum amount of the time over here. So again, a lot of algorithms are put in place. The computer softwares, some of the softwares will even calculate it automatically for you on the simple algorithms, and they will tell you the earliest and the latest possible start and finish time for the project activities. It also estimates the dependencies among them to create a schedule of the critical activities and the dates surrounding that. And that's how, you know, you lay down a critical path analysis to say that if I have a dependency, how do I mitigate this dependency? I have got a, you know, date conflict, how do I mitigate that particular thing? And what is the shortest path to achieve this out. Then obviously the next thing which comes in is that how do you compress the schedule? Because in any project, the schedule can, you know, extend, and you should be able to contain it and compress it out. And that's where you apply the two approaches over here. One is the crashing. That means that you would assign a lot of resources to the activity, therefore reducing the time it takes to complete it out. But it is on an assumption, two assumptions, that extra resources are available and they are, you know, not going to add the cost beyond what we want. But and the second thing is that extra resources will actually make a dent or actually help you to compress the timelines. Okay, sometimes it is not possible even with the extra resources because of the other constraints. And the second thing is that you do the fast tracking. So that is what involves in, you know, doing a lot of parallel working. So if I take an example of the lean over here, when we take a quick changeover, we do the internal and external activities. So we try to do as many activities as possible in an external way that is in parallel, so that while we are doing the core things, other things are happening simultaneously. And that's how we try to fast track whatever we are doing and compress our schedule over here. So that's another area into this. The part of this entire thing obviously comes in as in terms of, you know, if I have got a schedule, I should be able to review it. I should be able to run the what if scenario analysis. I should be able to do the resource labeling. I should be able to have a critical chain method into this, so that if, you know, the resources are not available and there is a some kind of a, you know, link between one activity to another, and that is not feasible to, you know, handle because of maybe we are running short of time or we are running short of the resources, then how do you actually manage those work disruptions? And then again, the risk multipliers, because we know that risk is inevitable. So how do we, you know, maybe save some time for the high risk activities, or how do we add, you know, a time multiplier to certain tasks or certain resource so that we can optimize and optimistically, you know, reduce the time estimates over here. Okay. Normally it is a very simple way of defining it in a very simplistic way. Of course, I'm making it sound as simple, but when you start doing the complex projects, it's not so simple as well. But the steps are simple. You do the activity definition, you do the sequencing of the activities, you do the activity duration and estimations, and then you do the development of the schedule based upon all these activities defined, their estimates and the sequencing, and then you develop a schedule control mechanism overall. Okay, so that's how we prepare the schedules over here. So this is the schedule development. The second thing which I wanted to take as a major one was the risk management. And risk management is a very important part. So risk analysis is actually a major part, which in most of the project management is virtually not present. Okay. We always focus on the cost and schedule. We try to focus on, you know, delivering the projects onto the time and budget. And we don't see that, you know, we don't realize that the risk we run into delivering the project. We always believe that, you know, nothing will go wrong and we have planned it well, so why the risk will occur? But risk can occur in multiple ways. And that's why it is very important that you recognize that what kind of the risk could happen and focus upon them. So when you look in the PMBOK, the project risk management knowledge area has actually identified the 7 processes: the plan risk management, identify risk, perform qualitative risk, perform the quantitative risk analysis, plan the risk responses, implement the risk responses, and monitor the risk on an ongoing basis. Okay. So the first step is plan risk management. Oh, I'm sorry, the slide is not very clear. So this first thing is that, you know, you have a risk management plan. Actually, you create a risk management plan, which is, you know, how many risk I might have. I have a category of the risk. Category of the risk could be market, procurement, resources, natural disasters, you know, stakeholder satisfaction, technology. These are all various kinds of the risk which could be there. And we determine the timing and procedures for reassessing all this kind of risk and definitions of risk probability and impact. Okay, it's a big subject. It's a big subject in its own. And large projects, usually people do deploy the risk management over here. But normally people give it a skip when they talk about the small projects over here. Okay. Then we sit down to identify the risk, and that is where we look that, you know, what kind of the potential risk can happen, whether to the cost, schedule, or the scope, and whether any kind of a success factor can be, you know, impacted, creating a risk to the entire project. Okay, so that's where we create a checklist. We also use, you know, expert judgment. We also use the previous project experience. We also talk to our people, try to understand that, you know, what they have gone through. And we also constantly not only identify the risk, we also identify the opposite of it, which is the opportunities. There could be also, you know, potentially opportunities of cost saving or schedule saving, or, you know, taking advantage of some of the opportunities which could help us to propel the project faster. All in all, we put them everything into, you know, a risk register. We try to, you know, capture as much as we can, but obviously we can't, you know, anticipate, or we can't put everything into a risk register. So we take the very critical ones which we think. We may even do the brainstorming with the project team and take their inputs also, and that is what we put it as a risk register. Okay, once we have a risk register, we need to prioritize the risk. And that's where we try to look whether what the probability of the occurrence of this particular risk and what impact it will cause. Okay, so if you have a priority matrix, which is, you know, putting up a probability of the occurrence and the impact which it will have, then based upon this, we can assign the risk some kind of a ranking. And then this ranking helps us to, you know, decide that in which order we should be addressing these risks or create a risk management plan over here. Okay. The next comes in as the quantitative risk analysis. And that is where we try to, you know, use the risk priorities which we established. And based upon this, we try to assess the impact onto the schedule and the budget. And we also give that, you know, what is the probability estimate, maybe 90%, 70% likelihood. And maybe even draw a bell curve kind of a style distribution. And that is where then we, you know, start looking up that how we will do the overall cost and schedule into the entire project using this bell curve. So sometimes the bell curve or the Monte Carlo analysis is also done. And that's where you try to, you know, project or predict what kind of the risk you could have. In large projects, usually you will end up having the complex softwares which will help you to, you know, do the risk assessments and risk calculations overall. Once you have got the risk quantified and qualified, then obviously you would like to, you know, have a response for this particular project, a risk, so that, you know that what you can do. And you also set up a response plan, which also could be that how do you monitor in case there is a risk which happens, what triggers it, so that, you know, you have an early possible warning. Okay. Then obviously after the risk has been, risk response has been created, you create a risk response plan. So whenever a risk occurs, the risk plan which you have put in, that is, you know, implemented immediately, and you can recover from that risk to the best possible extent over here. And needless to say, throughout the project, you will keep on, you know, monitoring that whether any kind of risk is likely to happen or has happened, whether the risk is being mitigated properly, whether the risk is not even occurring, has not even occurred, but is likely to occur still at the end of the fag end of the project also. So you keep on, you know, monitoring the risk for the possibility of its occurrence or its impact onto the project over here. Okay. The third important area which I wanted to talk, and then after that, I think I should be able to close my presentation, is the monitoring and control. Okay. So the monitoring and control process, and this is a process area, it's not a knowledge area. This actually oversees all the tasks and the metrics which are necessary to ensure that the approved and authorized project remains within the scope, time, and budget. Okay. And it proceeds with a minimal risk. So we have to constantly monitor and control our project. And this involves comparing actual performance with planned and performance, and even taking the corrective action to yield the desired outcome whenever we see any kind of a variation occurring over here. So once the project execution phase gets under the way, that is where the controlling and monitoring phase also starts in parallel, because it has to end-to-end continuously monitor and ensure that all the knowledge areas and all the process areas which we are working upon are constantly monitored for the success. Okay, so it is a complete life cycle in which we continue to look into it, and it runs in tandem along with the execution phase overall. Okay. The result of this executing processes, whatever we are going to execute as part of, you know, cost management or the quality management or the procurement management and so on and so forth, we again, you know, constantly compare the result of these management plans and see that, you know, if there are any kind of differences existing. And if the differences start coming in, then obviously we need to take the corrective action to either change the plan itself or the way in which the plan is being executed. And point of this exercise is to take in account what is being learned from the execution of the plan and to replan on the basis of this new information so that we can, you know, prevent the future project work from becoming too detached over the plan. Okay. So evaluation and comparison of the actual measured results against those planned is the fundamental principle of this process group overall. Okay. So this is where the variance corrective action is required to keep the project on the schedule and on the budget. Sorry, very sorry. So here again, the inputs into monitoring and control are the project plan and the progress report, which contains the data collected from the project team. And when the progress deviates significantly, this usually means that outside of a predetermined tolerance, it is important that we identify the underlying cause and take the corrective action to bring it back onto the track. Okay. So reporting mechanisms over here have to be time sensitive, and we should be able to take the appropriate actions as and when the deviations occur. If the reporting mechanism is not appropriate, it is slow, then we may not be able to control the project because errors might have happened and we might have, you know, gone out of the control because of that. Okay. So what is the control framework you would apply? It will actually vary from project to project. It will also vary from size and complexity of the project and also the extent to which the different levels of management are involved into it. Okay. So short projects are actually, you know, susceptible to high degree of changes and uncertainty, and they will require shorter reporting cycle. But if you have a longer project, then usually the longer projects are more stable than the shorter project because you have larger resources available, including the financial side, to be able to plan and estimate it better and control your risk in a more efficient way. Okay. So best control systems, which can happen, are often the simplest, and making the data collection process complex only, you know, would increase the cost and the possibility of error. So what we require over here is the accuracy and timeliness of the data collection process, because it can be influenced by the series of the practical issues and even overall attitude of the project management staff. So honesty, objectivity, accuracy, up to date, timeliness, they are the important factors in the control systems being built and the reporting being carried out over here. Okay. So quality of this data which we get as part of the reporting, it is absolutely critical to the success of the project. And a lot of projects actually run into trouble because the what progress was reported actually doesn't match with is happening on the grounds level. And we have come across multiple things where the higher management always gets a report of a good, you know, status of the project, where on the grounds level, actually certain things are not going right. Okay. So there is a communication issue and there is also bad reporting which is happening, or a dishonest reporting which is happening over here. Okay. Okay. So when we do this thing as part of this entire process of monitoring and control, we may even have the multiple workflows which may be happening simultaneously, and we need to also manage them side by side into it, which could be even, you know, like the change request from the client, or maybe one of the financial issues associated with it, and so on and so forth. But control mechanism has to be in place to ensure that, you know, we have an eye or we have a watch on the variables which are affecting the project and ensure that we are able to, you know, control them and get them into the shape over here. Okay. So to sum up, project management objective is to produce a complete project which complies with the client's objectives. And project management actually has been around for centuries. It has evolved in terms of the tools, techniques, processes, and knowledge areas. Project managers are the first point of contact for any issue or discrepancies arising. Project management has been divided into 5 process groups: initiation, planning, execution, monitoring and control, and closure. And similarly, you have the 10 knowledge areas, which is integration management, scope management, time or schedule management, cost management, resource management, communication management, quality management, procurement management, risk management, and stakeholder management. Okay, these five process areas are mapped to the 10 knowledge areas, and they all have the, you know, further technical areas identified within that for working. Okay, schedule development is part estimation, part prediction, and part educated guess, taking in various, you know, consideration various factors. And this actually transformed the project from a scheduling exercise, actually transformed the project from a vision to a time-based plan. And scheduling tools can include several, you know, tools like the schedule network analysis, critical path analysis, or schedule compression. Risk management is made up of seven processes: plan risk management, identify risk, perform quantity risk analysis, perform qualitative risk analysis, risk responses, risk response implementation, and risk monitoring. Okay. Monitoring and controlling process oversees all the tasks and metrics necessary to ensure that the approved and authorized projects within a scope, on time, and on budget, so that the project proceeds with a minimal risk. And this process involves, you know, the comparing actual performance with the planned performance and taking corrective action to yield the desired result when the significant differences exist. Okay. So friends, project management is actually the science and art together of organizing all the components of a project. For example, the launching of a new service or a marketing campaign or development of a new product, they're all projects. And at the same time, even, you know, if I come back and say, even a wedding planning is also a project. Okay, that also requires some kind of a project management overall, right? So examples of these projects may include even the construction of a new bridge or building, or even developing a software, or setting up a new factory, or relief effort for a natural disaster, or setting up a strategy to break up into a new sales geography. All these are the projects, and they all have to be managed out over here, right? So having said all these things, project management is a vast area. It does require substantial time to, you know, understand it and go through this. So if you want to have a complete, you know, project on time, you need to manage it well. You also need to make sure that you're within the budget, and you must not only work on meeting the deadline, but you should also ensure that it meets the quality expectation, right? So project management, therefore, I would say, is the application of techniques, tools, skills, and knowledge to make sure that all the project requirements are met. So at Orion University and Skilltelligent, if you want, we can always conduct the full training programs on the project management, and maybe even look up at your specific project management requirement needs, and then, you know, help you to align your project management techniques to meet your project requirements, or maybe even look at the lean project management culture development in your organization. Okay. So thank you very much for attending this webinar. I hope this has been helpful. If you have any questions, we can take them now. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you for such a wonderful presentation. The session was indeed a very insightful session. We'll start the questions one by one. The first one: what are the mainly bottleneck of project management, except then finance, delay in the project, and maybe the big bottleneck? So according to you, what are the basic kind of big bottlenecks?
What are the big bottlenecks into the project?
Project management.
Multiple things. In fact, actually, all the knowledge areas which are identified, they all can be major benefit bottlenecks. And it also depends upon the type of the project which you're running into. Technical projects, the technology can become a major bottleneck. Okay. Sometimes even the financial resources to procure the technology or the tools to, you know, mitigate that situation can also be a bottleneck into it. Large construction projects, resources are a major bottleneck over there, because you have to have the right kind of the people, right kind of the skill sets over there, and timely availability. So it really depends upon, you know, what type of the project you are into, and then what kind of the typical requirement it has got, that determines the, you know, type of the bottlenecks over here.
Thank you, sir. Next question: what are the important KPIs used in PM, that is in project management?
Multiple of them. Schedule, cost, and scope variance, they are, you know, the most important KPIs. If I have got a variance into that, any of these, you know, three areas, I'm not going to be able to deliver my project to the full satisfaction. Okay, so these three become the important one. And then you have the subtypes within each of them, which come down into it. So it could be even the earned value variance over there. There can be multiple of them, but this cost, schedule, and the scope variance, they are the top ones into a project management.
Thank you, sir. How do we reduce the communication gap between planning and execution team?
That's a evergreen problem. Mm-hmm. And it is not something, you know, which is only into the project management. We have seen it constantly on the shop floor also. In fact, one of the projects which we are doing right now, we see that as a major issue, that what the planning is saying versus what the activities on the shop floor are happening are two, you know, diverse angles into it. Okay. So the commitment to the customer is something different. And what is happening on the shop floor is always a constant fight to somehow or the other make the ends meet. And in that process, the customer commitments do not get met. And these are all nothing but the, you know, the communication issues, because what has been planned has not been communicated well. And even if the production has got certain issues, or, you know, the shop floor has got certain issues, or the project teams have got certain issues, they don't communicate it well back. So there are assumptions which float between both the sides, and people go as per that particular assumption. So what is required is that you have to have, you know, effective project management meetings. You have to have the very structured, regular, and very frequent, you know, review meetings, which are the status updates, which are not the problem solving meetings. You have to have risk analysis meetings on an ongoing basis. And I would actually, you know, encourage the planning team to do the Gemba, actually go down to the project sites and then be part of the project site to watch and come back and see that whether things are moving as planned or not. So review meetings, status update meetings, regular communications, maybe when doing the Gemba walks over there, all these things are some of the things by which we can ensure that there is a lesser communication gap between the planning and the other side of it.
Thank you, sir. Is regression and correlation useful for calculation of PERT CPM in project management?
Yeah, we do. We do actually, you know, a lot of correlations and regressions as part of the PERT CPM. This has to be done. So this is part of the PERT CPM calculations overall.
Which project management tool is better for reporting or taking the progress?
Again, people will have, you know, multiple choices over here. Primavera is also a very good project management tool. MS Project is always all-time favorite to a lot of people. There are, you know, good amount of Excel-based project management tools as well. And then there are dedicated project tools which are embedded even into, you know, ERPs these days, because they also, you know, cater to the project management at some point. So it really depends upon what is the size of the project, what is the cost you can afford for such kind of the project management tools, and complexity of the project. So multiple of them are available. You can start from a simple Excel sheet. Even if you take a simple Excel, it has got a template for a basic project management, including creating a Gantt chart and a network chart and so on and so forth. So you can start from that and go up to, you know, any limit you want to. It really depends upon your requirements.
Thank you. Is project management a part of the operations management?
Yes and no. Project management is a discipline by itself, and it's a major discipline. If you're executing a new project, you require a project management separately. However, if you are into the operations and you are into a, you know, a continuous improvement, or you are enhancing the capability within a particular operations or something like that, then the project management has to coordinate and work along with the operation management. But except that kind of a correlation or that kind of a handholding, they remain as the two separate, you know, disciplines.
Thank you, sir. How project management plays a role in process industry and any automobile industry?
Project management is everywhere. So as I said, you know, even if you want to plan a wedding, you know, even wedding is a project these days. So of course, in the pandemic, the number of people have reduced, but otherwise Indian weddings have got, you know, hundreds and 200, 500,000 people. So managing catering, managing, you know, the decorations, managing the, you know, rituals, managing the movement of the people or the place, and even the parking and everything, they're all projects. So you say, you know, tasks to be done. So it's a project overall. Okay. So project management plays also a role into every industry. Process industry, every time I set up and increase my process capability, or I have a changeover into my existing equipments to a new process or a new, you know, product, I need a project management over there. If I am into automobile, again, automobile developing a new product right from beginning to the end, or setting up the new assembly lines, or switching over from one, you know, type of the product offering to the another product offering. These are all kind of, you know, the project managements over here. Some of these things could also be qualifying as a change management, but change management also usually, you know, qualifies or asks for a project management as a subset of it also. So they're all interlinked, and the project management always will play a very important role across the board.
Thank you, sir. With this, we have come to the end of the session today. Thank you, sir, for such a wonderful presentation. We have learned today that project management is the application of methodologies, tools, and processes to successfully plan and execute projects. Project management intelligently makes use of teams and resources to complete project activities within the boundaries of time, cost, and scope. Our next webinar will be on the benchmarking for quality improvement on Thursday, that is 13th of May 2021, same time, it is 4 p.m. I take this opportunity to thank Atul sir for being with us and apprising us on the subject. I would like to thank all the participants and look forward to see you on the 13th of May for the next session. Till then, stay safe. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone.